You're listening to Civic Media. You can tune into any of our live shows on any radio station across the state with the Civic Media app. Find us in your phone's app store and listen anytime, anywhere.
Live from the Civic
You're
Media
listening
studios
to pre-recorded content produced by Civic Media.
Broadcasting live from the Civic Media Studios in Green Bay, this is Nite Lite with Pete Schwaba, your inside source on everything entertainment from Wisconsin to Hollywood. And now, a man barely 6 feet tall, but a mountain of muscle, Pete Schwaba.
We are back for hour number two of this Thursday night edition of Nite Lite, broadcasting statewide from our beautiful studios here in Green Bay, Wisconsin, downtown Green Bay. The studio is in disarray. Conrad is surrounded by monitors. I don't know what kind of tomfoolery is going on. So a couple weeks ago, you and I were at Sputnik Fest, which was really fun. You sort of set that up, which was fantastic, and I had a blast. And your child won a second place, was it?
It was second place, and it honestly astounded me because I purposely didn't let you see him or even know it was my kid, so no one can tell me that I bribed a judge.
Listen, you tried like heck to bribe me. I did not take your bribe because that's the kind of guy I am. But I'm happy your son won anyway. He had a great costume. Even if you bribed, he would have won. He had six arms. It was fantastic. But one of the other judges, she was tough. And this is Jenna Watkins, who we met that day, who was very nice. And we decided to invite her on Tonight Light a couple weeks ago. And here is that interview with Jenna. Okay, so last weekend, as I mentioned earlier in the show, I was a judge at Sputnik Fest in Manitowoc, and it was really fun, and I met this woman named Jenna Watkins, who is Miss Harbor City. She was one of the other judges, and another guy named Craig, who was great, who worked for another local radio station. We had a lot of fun hanging out and judging costumes, and I thought, you know, Jenna's got to come on the show, tell us what she's watching, and she has some really cool stuff to talk about. Usually when you win some kind of pageant or you have a title, you have issues that are important to you that you get to champion and work with, and she does that. So we'll talk to her a little bit about that because she's joining us now on Nite Lite. Jenna, how are you?
Hi, I'm great, Pete. How are you doing?
Doing very well. Did you have fun at Sputnik Fest?
Oh, I had a blast. I got a picture with Darth Vader. Were you able to get that picture?
Oh, I don't think I did. I didn't even see Darth Vader.
Oh, he was hanging around. It was so much fun.
Can we Photoshop me into the picture and I get a copy of that?
Oh, absolutely. I'll send it to you after the show.
Put that high in your list of priorities, will you, Jenna?
Absolutely.
Was that your favorite moment of the day? I thought that was kind of a fun time. I remember freezing because I wore shorts and it was like 30 below in Manitowoc that day, but it was fun.
Oh, I think the best part was seeing all of the costumes. I think every single costume was homemade, and just the effort that was put into all of the different outfits that people wore at Sputnik Fest was truly inspiring.
And it's cool because, like, even if they weren't in the costume contest, they were just embracing what the day was. They were dressed as aliens. They had radio antennas on their head. Like, it was just kind of a really fun thing to see people buy into something that's just kind of fun.
Oh, yes. It was such a fun day.
Yeah. So, all right. So tell us, how did you become Miss Harbor Cities, and what does that mean exactly? What is the area that encompasses that title, Miss Harbor Cities?
Yes. So last September, I competed in the Miss Harbor Cities competition. I originally started competing in Miss America about 5 years ago because I wanted to overcome my social anxiety. I suffer from social anxiety and problems talking with people, like many people my age. And I thought, what a better way to work to overcome this than to be in a position that basically forces me to talk to people?
Yeah.
And so, yeah, I've been competing for a couple of years. And Miss Harbor Cities encompasses the entirety of Wisconsin, but really focuses on the Manitowoc and Two Rivers areas.
Okay. And where are you from, Jenna?
I'm from the Milwaukee area, specifically Waukesha County.
Okay. Oh, very nice. So you have this title. Like, how did that work? You were competing for Miss America, and then is this a separate entity altogether, the Miss Harbor Cities?
So Miss Harbor Cities competes at Miss Wisconsin in June.
Okay.
And then whoever wins Miss Wisconsin, which was Mandy Genord this year, she's actually going to be competing to become Miss America. I believe the dates were just announced as January.
Okay.
So that's really
that's
exciting for her, and I can't wait to cheer her on.
And you were saying to the coordinator, Greg, that your time as Miss Harbor Cities is up soon and someone will take over. And then what's on tap for you? Do you get like a serious pension and you get to kick back with a bunch of proceeds? How does that work?
No, I am continuing my volunteer work. So my community service initiative is If Your Identity Protect It, because when I was 16 years old, my identity was stolen. So I'm going to continue volunteering and teaching people how to protect their identity, just because I'm no longer going to be Miss Harbor Cities as of September 22nd doesn't mean that I'm going to stop volunteering and teaching people.
Well, good for you. I think that's kind of, you know, it fascinates me the topics that people choose to champion when they have a title like this. And that's the first time I've ever heard of someone wanting to protect people or enlighten them on how to protect their identities. Especially you seem like a pretty young person, and to get your identity stolen at 16, what was that like trying to get it back and try to just kind of reclaim yourself, so to speak?
It was really hard because I went to my parents and I said, what do I do? And it was the first time that my parents looked at me and said, I don't know.
Yeah.
So I always say that was the moment that I well and truly grew up. Because my parents couldn't tell me what to do with my life. Like, they couldn't even give me guidance. Thankfully, if you can say that with identity theft, the attackers only got my bank account. So I was able to work with my bank to crawl my funds back into my account. It was a long process. And after I finished feeling sorry for myself, I grew really resilient. And I said, I never want to feel this way. And moreover, I don't want anyone else to feel this way. So I started learning everything I could about cybersecurity. And then I started teaching everyone that I met about cybersecurity, even if it's just how to make stronger passwords.
That is really okay. That's interesting that you say that, because I saw a statistic earlier this week that says the most popular password for your internet accounts, various accounts, is 123456. Like, have people not learned anything? Like, my passwords probably aren't the most secure, but I'm not doing that. You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm. So the problem with the human brain is that the human brain is not made to remember passwords. So what I tell people when creating passwords is envision a location in your house. For me, I love the kitchen. I love to cook. I love to bake. So I always envision my kitchen whenever I'm creating a password. So like one item in my kitchen isn't a strong password. For example, my stove. My stove isn't a strong password. But if I have my stove, flowers, and my sink, well, those put together are a strong password. And to remember it, all I need to do is think of my kitchen.
Oh, that's interesting. But what about all the characters at the end? That's what loses me. Like, you know, my password for all my accounts is just Producer Conrad. That's what I type in, and people. No, I'm kidding. No, but it's the characters, right? That I always have trouble, you know, remembering. And I have so many. You need a password for everything, Jenna. How do you like? I keep a file on my computer. I used to keep them in an email that I would never send because I feel like, you know, they can hack your email. But if I kept it in a draft, is that safe?
No, because they can still see your drafts.
If they get into the cloud or something?
Yep.
Oh,
and
boy.
If they hack into your email, they can still see your drafts.
Okay.
But what you can do is you can have a password manager where you only need to remember one super strong password, and you're going to think I'm crazy, but only have your password be maybe 30 to 40 characters, which I know sounds a lot.
Whoa.
But it's only one password you need to remember, and
okay.
That's a sentence. So all you need to remember is one sentence, and then all of your passwords are at your fingertips.
And then with the sentence, though, like typically these companies, they want you to add a number and an asterisk or an exclamation point or whatever. Are you saying just do the sentence?
No. So the sentence opens up your password vault. Oh. And then your password vault, just like a vault that you that the banks use or a safe that you store inside your house, it has all of your password files in there, and your password vault will actually make your passwords for you.
Oh,
so
wow.
You can say, oh, this website needs this. So you can just type it in, and you don't need to remember the gibberish password that these websites are requiring.
That's a really great idea. If we've learned nothing else here tonight, and we haven't, we have this going for us. So thank you for that. So do you work for a company doing that? Or are you just like freelance? And I will say, I thought that was really cool. I don't hear, like I said, many, you know, winners of these pageants talking about stuff like this, but I also don't like, I think you told me the other day, you don't have a huge desire. Like a lot of people that enter contests want to be TV personalities or models or actors. Do you have any desire to do that kind of stuff? Or are you happy doing cybersecurity?
I'm really happy doing cybersecurity because it means that I'm protecting people. It means that I'm able to prevent what happened to me happening to someone else.
Right. Oh, that's great. All right. Well, we've learned that, and I think that's fantastic. So, what do you do? I'm sorry, I'm geeking out on this, but I'm really fascinated by cybersecurity. We've seen movies where you see how important that work is. What is a typical day? Like you get to work. Are you actually tracking hackers and people that do that? And have you ever caught anybody?
Yes, that's actually a large part of my job is tracking hacker movements, informing my bosses and my leadership about what they are doing and figuring out if there are any holes that maybe the attackers could get in and trying to close them up so then the attackers can't use that to their advantage. I personally have not caught any hackers yet.
Okay.
But if I do, I'll make sure that you're the first to know, Pete.
If you wanted to right now, I'm not saying you do this. Could you hack into Conrad, all his personal stuff?
Please don't.
I'm going to say no for legal reasons.
All right. Very smart.
And no for skill reasons as well.
Oh, come on. All right. Jenna Watkins is here. She's Miss Harbor Cities for a few more days anyway, and she does cybersecurity. And we are learning a lot. We'll have more with Jenna after a very short break here. This is Pete Schwaba in Nite Lite on the Civic Media Radio Network. To another place in my life, everything is beautiful. And no wants to need no sign.
You're listening to pre-
You know that song? That reminds me of the Saturday Night Live song where they used to dance to What is Love? That Hathaway song, Chris Kattan and Will Ferrell.
Yeah, yep.
It's kind of like a very similar song. And I saw a clip of Sylvester Stallone doing that dance with them, and he was fantastic. It was hilarious. You should Google it. But don't let Jenna Watkins catch you Googling something you shouldn't be Googling. She's our guest right now, ladies and gentlemen. And she's Miss Harbor Cities for about another week or a couple weeks. And she does cybersecurity by day. And I think that's really cool. All right. So, Jenna, we were talking about kind of your typical day. I'm fascinated by what you do because I think that seems like it is the crime nowadays. It all seems like it's online crimes. Everybody's inside. Everybody's on their computer. Who do people that do this typically target? Is there a type they go after?
There are a couple of different people that they go after. So if you're in corporate and you're working, they go after people in HR and they go after people who are in technology. And that's simply because of either the amount of information that you have access to or the amount of permissions that you have. If you think of people who are in HR, they have a lot of data at their fingertips.
Yes.
Just off the top of my head, HR probably has your personal address, your email address, phone numbers, maybe your social security numbers. And HR has all of that data on a file on all of the employees that work for them and have worked for them in the past. In IT, you have all of these permissions where you're able to push code, you're able to download from the web, which attackers find very beneficial in publishing ransomware, for example, into the company, and then they're able to get paid.
Wow.
For the civilians, attackers really target senior citizens, unfortunately, which makes me a little angry, I'll admit
sure.
it.
That's, wow, that's, you know, I'm terrified mm-hmm. of people finding out my shoe size. Like, you can have my social security number, I don't care about my bank account, but I will be damned if I want people knowing what size. I wear a 6. Jenna, you laughed so reluctantly.
Well, make sure
that was great.
Aired, right?
You're kind of like acting like a security person. Like, I'm not sure I should laugh at that or if I should bust him. So, Jenna, is there a type of person or profile of hackers? Like, is it, you know, are they angry people? Are they college dropouts that were techno geniuses? Like, is there a profile? And if so, can you share who these people are, generally speaking?
There's really not, but I can tell you these people's 9-to-5 is hacking you and scamming you. That's their 9-to-5. They Man. Don't have another job.
That's crazy. And they make a living at that. Like some people probably get rich doing this, right?
Oh, they get wealthy, not just rich.
No kidding. Is it too late for me to become a hacker?
I mean, it's never too late, but might I advise you to become a white hat hacker?
What's
Those are the good guys.
Oh, see, I think that we could be partners. All right. It'd be like a cop show. I'll make a citizen's arrest. You go to the bosses. I'll be the cop with the bad attitude who smokes, and you be kind of the straighter. You be the Boy Scout, so to speak. I think that could work.
Works for me.
Okay. All right. So, Jenna, tell us what, all right, you've had a long day chasing hackers. You've done your duties as Miss Harbor Cities. Now you're home. You're in your kitchen. You like to cook. What are you putting on TV? What do you watch?
Every single night, I watch MASH.
The MASH, the old TV show?
Yes.
No kidding.
It has been tradition in my household ever since I was young. MASH is the cooking and the dinner show.
Really? So like growing up, that's what your parents watched, that kind of thing?
Yes. And now being an adult myself, it is not a day without MASH.
No kidding.
That's... Like, it doesn't feel right.
I was not expecting that, I'll be honest. I love hearing things I don't expect. Do you like the do you like the new MASH, or the more recent ones? I mean, they're all old at this point, but do you like the early cast or the later cast?
I have to say, I love the old cast just because I love Henry.
Yes.
Henry is such a good commander.
Henry Blake is great.
He just warms my heart.
Yeah, he's great. To me, that show went downhill when he left a little bit, and because I liked Frank Burns, I like Trapper, and I like Henry, mm-hmm. and the rest of them were great. David Ogden Stiers was great as Charles, and Harry, yeah. Harry Potter, Henry Potter. I don't remember. Was Colonel Potter.
Henry.
But yeah, when Potter. Like Klinger took over. And they made, that was like, Klinger was funny when it was like a secondary character. Oh, it's a guy in a dress. That's hilarious. But when they made him seem crazier, I didn't think that was as funny. And I didn't think it was as funny as when Alan Alda got up on his soapbox and like, you know, kind of took over and made it very dramatic. It just wasn't as enjoyable for me then.
Mm-hmm. I loved when it was so lighthearted.
Yeah.
I think with Winchester and Potter playing off of each other, it got a little too deep.
Interesting.
But
yeah.
I have to say, like Hawkeye's war isn't hell speech.
Yeah.
Still stands out to me.
Yeah. And they did some great stuff on that show. No question about it. But I just thought like the first 5 years of it, one of the best sitcoms of all time. Like it was that funny. And when they were cutting one of my favorite episodes is when the bomb lands on the camp and they're trying to take the bomb apart. And I think it's
yes!
Henry. Yeah, he's reading the directions. He says, cut the red wire. So they cut it, and he goes, but first. Oh, that's funny.
And the comedy still stands up to today.
Yeah, for sure.
Like, do you know how difficult that is?
Exactly.
Decades later, the comedy still stands.
That's impressive. I was not expecting to hear that from you. And I love when I'm talking to people and they throw something at me. Because to be honest, I forgot about MASH. I haven't watched an episode of MASH in years. So that's a great answer. Last question for you. And I know you're not going to give me a truthful answer, but when you were judging costumes at Sputnik Fest, did you take bribes? Answer the question honestly, please.
I never take bribes. Unless they're in the form of chocolate. You're in which it's 85% dark. Otherwise, nothing.
All right. You're a Boy Scout. You're the one that always has to get me off the hook with the boss. We're going to be cyber partners. It's going to be great. Check out, hey, Jenna, down by Milwaukee in Kenosha there, Sandy's Popper. Great popcorn. They have chocolate drizzle, all kinds of stuff. Some of it sounded so delicious, you don't even need the popcorn, really. But it's great stuff. And I can't thank you enough for your time tonight. I'm glad we met, and I wish you luck with your last few days here as Miss Harbor Cities, and keep fighting the good fight online. We need that.
Thank you. And thank you for having me on, Pete.
Anytime. Let's stay in touch. All right. Have a great night.
You too.
All right. Bye. That's Jenna Watkins, Miss Harbor Cities, at least for another couple weeks. I've got a really fun guest. Al Pitrelli joins us. He's the musical director and the guitarist of this legendary band, the Trans-Siberian Orchestra. This is Pete Schwab.
You're listening to Civic Media. Find the latest news, information, and archives of all your favorite shows on the Civic Media website, civicmedia.us. We are deeply appreciative. You want a guy shout and get the hell out of town. Don't be a baby, remember what you told me. Okay, so a couple weeks ago, this was really fun. I had Al Pitrelli on. He's the musical director and guitarist for the Trans-Siberian Orchestra. TSO, as they're known. What do you know about them? Like, did you grow up hearing this band? Amanda, you're younger than me.
I'm an orchestra kid. So I've played viola for 20 years. I know everything there is to know about orchestras.
Do you still play?
I do occasionally. I need a new bow right now. My bow broke. But I've always wanted to see the Trans-Siberian Orchestra, and I never have.
Listen, I'll buy you a bow. You have to come in and play sometime. That would be so fun.
I can only do so much now. You want some green sleeves?
Yeah, green sleeves is great. You could be like the house band, just a single viola player. I think that would be hilarious. So you're a fan. I'm a fan. I didn't know about them till they came out in the mid-90s, and I was like, this is such a different sound. So it was so cool to have Al on the show, and he turned out to be a really good guest. We had a lot of fun with him. And his answers were great. And here is my interview with Al Pitrelli from the Trans-Siberian Orchestra from a couple weeks ago.
All right. I'm very excited to welcome our next guest to Nite Lite. He is a very accomplished musician and the musical director and guitarist for a wildly popular group known as TSO, a.k.a. the Trans-Siberian Orchestra. Al Pitrelli joins us now here on Nite Lite. Hi, Al.
Hey, how are you tonight, sir?
Doing great. How are you?
Good. And the $10,000 fee, does that include my daughter? Because if you sat down and watched Godfather 1 and 2 with her, you're going to pay me $10,000 to run out the door, I promise you.
I'll tell you what. I made a film a few years ago called The Godfather of Green Bay. I'll give your I'll give your daughter $20 to watch it. It's Tony Goldwyn, Lauren Holly, and me.
Listen, she's 8 years old, so she's got the attention span of a gnat, so I'm not sure how this is going to go.
Okay. That's great. Where are you guys based out of, Al?
New York City and Tampa Bay, Florida.
Okay. Because I got to be honest, when I didn't live in the Midwest when TSO kind of came on the scene, and I was like, what is this sound? This is so different and pretty cool, and it was so wildly popular in Wisconsin. When I would come home to visit, I would hear it everywhere. And I thought you guys were from Wisconsin just because that's where I heard it.
Well, it's the craziest thing because when it hit radio, and this is going back almost 30 years ago, it'll be 30 years next, 1 year from now, we're basically on year 29.
Wow.
And like you said, nobody had ever heard anything like that before. And it just took America by storm. And we had the number one requested song in America that year and every year following.
Really?
You know, it's the craziest thing. And I'm so proud of what it's become.
And how did you, I know it was started by a guy named Paul O'Neill. Have you been with it the entire time, but you took over as musical director? How did that work?
No, I was Paul's musical director from the jump.
Oh, okay.
He called me up in February of 1995, and he said he was working on this kind of concept track. And he knew that I had was Alice Cooper's musical director prior to that and had a lot of experience recording soundtracks. And instead of being like the typical guitar player, and he listened to a lot of guitar players come in and try to play on that track, but he wanted somebody with more of a cinematic approach to music.
Huh.
And when I came in, he explained the story behind the song to me, and I immediately got it and started playing that opening ostinato underneath God Rest You Merry Gentlemen, played on the cello. And he looked at me and he goes, "That's it. Let's keep going." And it was just one of those things. Like, I didn't, you know, I looked at him at the end of the session. I was like, "This is incredibly powerful, incredibly beautiful. What a wonderful piece of art you just created. I hope the world gets to hear it one day." And that's where I left it.
Okay, so realistically, you just created this great thing. You guys love it. When did you know you really had something? Like when you played it in front of a crowd for the first time, or when did you really know you were onto something?
I think I knew that we had something musically spectacular right there and then. But I you know, you talk about 1995. You know, the days of the Guitar Heroes were kind of over with for the most part. You know, the Seattle sound was really big on radio at that point. So I'm like, you know, I don't know where this is going to go, but you fast forward to, I'm going to say, early December that same year, 95, and one radio station in Tampa, Florida played it, and that was the first day. The next day, every radio programmer in America was playing that song. Now, you know, you got a hit when talk radio is playing your song.
You know? Right.
That's how you know you're onto something. Everybody's like, "What is this? I got to have more." And I knew right there we're onto something. Now, did I know it was going to last 30 years and turn into what it's turned into? No, I couldn't have seen that one coming. But I was really excited the fact that, wow, we're on the radio and people really love this. And, you know, there were some TV appearances after that and some other things. But when we recorded the record, the entire first TSO record, and I think it went, it sold 4 million copies in like a month in 96. And I'm like, you know, and I told Paul, I said, "Paul, you're onto something here. You're building something. You know, I just, let's go. Keep going. I'm with you for the whole run, wherever this goes."
That is great. Dude, you look like you could be in that Seattle scene. I'm just looking at pictures of you right now on the internet. You got that hard driving rock look, and you got the voice, man. You sound like you're from the East Coast. I have to say, I don't picture this kind of music just because I read a little bit about Paul too and his trip to Russia that he got some inspiration from. It sounds to me like cold weather music that just is hard driving right through the ice and freezing. It doesn't sound like Tampa music. It sounds like Midwest or East Coast music to me.
Yeah, well, you know, Paul, his family lives in Tampa, and we have our recording studio and production facility down in Tampa. But, you know, you're right. This was the first couple of records were recorded in the winter, you know, in New York City, you know. So it's not Siberian. It's certainly not Green Bay cold, but, you know, New York's cold enough.
Right.
And I remember walking from the subway to the studio, you know, through 6-7 inches of snow and sleet, being miserable, getting into the studio and putting my guitar around my neck or sitting behind the piano. And he's like, "All right, let's get to work." And we would start working at 5 to 6 in the evening and finish by 5 to 6 in the morning. And that's how it was back then.
Wow. All right. So what I love about this is, and I'm not telling you anything you haven't heard before a million times, I'm sure, but I'm getting a phone call while I'm in the air. That's great. But you have, like, there are religious overtones to it. And I never caught that before, but that's what I read about when I really kind of did a deep dive into you guys. As I just said, you look like a Seattle rocker or like Alice Cooper type rocker, but you got religious overtones, tattoos, but it's also Christmas music. It's so different and unique. Do you have a name for the genre that we haven't heard before?
No, it's kind of become its own thing.
Yeah.
You know, it really has. But if we go, you know, dig back into history a little bit, you know, Paul and I both grew up just outside of New York City. We come from Long Island. And, you know, where I grew up was literally, I think, 42 miles away from the Midtown Tunnel. Now, New York City might as well have been on Jupiter. It was a completely different world compared to growing up on Long Island. But, you know, some of us made a point of going into the city as much as humanly possible, you know, because that's where the music scene really was in the 70s. Now, you can go to Madison Square Garden back then and see Genesis, The Who, Pink Floyd, AC/DC, Kiss, whatever it would have been, right?
Yeah.
And you walk, you know, you walk, I don't know, 15 blocks north and you're at Radio City. And you walk another 10 blocks and you're in the theater district. you know, on Broadway, and you keep going, you're going to hit the Beacon and then Lincoln Center. So, you know, Leonard Bernstein conducting Mahler's Second Symphony at Lincoln Center. Andrew Lloyd Webber is one of his shows on Broadway. Every style, every genre of music is what we were exposed to and learned from and aspired to be. You know, growing up in the 60s, the only radio station I had was WABC AM.
Yeah.
You know, and the only two styles of music I was aware of was good music and bad music. You know, right. If you think about it back then, you know, so on the AM radio back in the 60s, one minute it was Barbra Streisand and Frank Sinatra. The next minute it's the Beach Boys and the Beatles. You had Motown. You had, you know, songs from The Sound of Music, South Pacific, West Side Story, whatever it was. This is what Paul and I were both individually exposed to and fell in love with musically. So when you fast forward to sitting down and writing a Trans-Siberian Orchestra record, it's basically a soundtrack written underneath a story that he wrote. So we're going to jump from style to style depending on the character in the story and what Paul's trying to express musically. So if you had to compare it to something, I would, you know, say, you know, something in Rodgers and Hammerstein world, you know, something that was a film score, but not a film.
Right. Oh, that's interesting. Did it start off as holiday music or did you guys just have a sound and you're like, let's go with this? And then it gravitated toward like holiday music or did you know right away?
No, it kind of, after Christmas Eve, Sarajevo 1224 hit at the radio, Paul knew he was onto something and he wrote an entire record around that one song. But the interesting thing about that song, it wasn't written as a Christmas song, you know. It was written as a soundtrack depicting events that took place on Christmas Eve during the war in Sarajevo. All right, so real quick history on this one. I was Alice Cooper's musical director and I played in Zagreb and Belgrade before the war. Okay. Yeah. And when I got into the studio with Paul in 95, he explained the story and the history behind it was that, and this is historically correct, a cellist from the area would walk down to the town square and play compositions by the great composers in protest of the bombing raids during the war. So when Paul told me that story, the hair on my arm stood up. I said, I was in that town square. I met a lot of great people while I was in Yugoslavia. And, unfortunately, they were killed in that war. Please press record right now. And that's where, you know, that kind of, that thing, that chemistry between us existed. When that song was a bona fide hit, he goes, let's write an entire record around this one song and see what happens. I'm like, I'm in. Let's go.
Wow. My guest is Al Pitrelli. He's the musical director for the Trans-Siberian Orchestra, also known as TSO, and he is their guitarist. And they are coming to Wisconsin. You're going to be at the Resch Center here in Green Bay November 13th, correct?
I believe so. I have my sheet right in front of me.
Okay.
Just professional and look. yes.
We got you covered.
Right.
Yeah.
And playing the Resch Center is fun as long as it's not on a Sunday afternoon when the Packers are playing.
Yeah, that's a traffic nightmare, as bad as traffic gets here in Northeast Wisconsin anyway.
But I'll take it.
Yeah. You got pre-sale tickets are on sale today. Everyone can buy tomorrow. Have you played the Resch before? I know you guys were at the Widener Center several years ago. I think.
Yeah, the Resch many times. Great room. And also, I think we're going to be the Pfizer Forum up in Milwaukee around the end of December, just before Christmas break.
Right. Okay. That's fantastic. And are those tickets on sale yet? Do you know?
Tomorrow morning. I mean, today was the pre-sales, but tomorrow it's up. You know, that's the official. Tickets are up. Let's go get them.
That's excellent. So we're on all over the state here. We will we'll pump these dates a little bit, too, as the dates get nearer. Do you... what's the name of the new tour? It's the Lost Christmas Eve? Is that what you're calling this tour? All right. So
yes,
is there a theme to that that's different than like last year where you had the Ghost of Christmas Eve?
Yeah. The Lost Christmas Eve was the third installment in Paul's Christmas trilogy.
Okay.
You know, we had three Christmas records that we put out. Christmas Eve and Other Stories, The Christmas Attic, and the third, of course, being The Lost Christmas Eve, like I just mentioned. And it is a different story than last year's presentation. One of the things that we pride ourselves in is never repeating ourselves or trying never to repeat ourselves. You know, we have a very loyal bunch of people in the audience that come back year after year that I affectionately refer to them as the repeat offenders. You know, and they've adopted or they've kind of made us part of their family holiday tradition, which is awesome. You know, like when I was a kid watching, you know, Charlie Brown's Christmas or A Miracle on 34th Street, whatever, you know, I love to go back and watch those old classics because they make me feel, you know, like I was a kid. You know, I have real fond memories of that 56 years ago. These people have kind of embraced us as a similar thing. So we always try to, you know, ride a very fine line between familiarity in the show and the story that they've fallen in love with and making it just different enough every year to keep everybody on their heels, you know? I don't ever want to become complacent. I don't ever want to repeat myself. And a lot of the times I'll compare it to, you know, like whoever wins the Super Bowl. Outstanding job. Congratulations, you guys. Did something incredible. You got the ring. You had the parade. Wonderful. That's in the rearview mirror. Now we got to do it again next year. There's no guarantee you're going to win again next year. You got to start from the ground up, rebuild the team, and do it all over again. That's what we try to do every year. We get back to work January, I don't know, second, third week in January, and start thinking about how can we make it even better. You know, and you're talking about 25 years of touring nonstop, with the exception of 2020 due to COVID.
And that makes it, you know, you got to keep it interesting for you guys as performers too. So I think that would be part of the motivation too. So just to keep things interesting and fresh. Al, I can't thank you enough for your time tonight. This has been really cool getting to know you from, and I'm fascinated by people's paths and their creative pursuits. You played with Megadeth, Alice Cooper, Asia. It's all led you to here, a wildly successful touring band with the Trans-Siberian Orchestra. So great. Continued success, Al, and please don't be a stranger.
Thank you so much, my friend. I've enjoyed our conversation, and I wish you and your family happy holidays if I don't speak to you before then.
Back at you. Safe travels, Al, and break a leg.
All right. Thank you, brother. Have
All
a
right,
great night.
You too. That's Al Pitrelli from the Trans-Siberian Orchestra. Conrad, have you seen them?
I have not, but I am really interested now in watching a YouTube video.
That's a great place to start. They are a spectacle. I mean, I will say, I saw them years and years ago, and they're so different. It's like you almost don't know what to make of them at first, and they just, man, they rock. All right, we're going to be back in just a couple minutes to close things down, and we'll think of something cool to talk about. Maybe Coke-flavored Oreos. Oh, we've already done that.
Don't you?
Listen, it's worth a sequel. That's our question tonight. So this is Pete Schwaba and Nite Lite. We'll be right back on the Civic.
Winston Churchill was the greatest villain of World War II. And he said that Hitler didn't really want to fight. And this kind of, you know, anti-Semitism that Tucker promoted, it's, you know, really Nazi propaganda. Then J.D. Vance, who, you know, after this had happened, obviously nobody in a leadership role should be giving interviews to Tucker, but they all still are. J.D. Vance did an interview with Tucker, I think, 2 days after he platformed this guy spreading Nazi propaganda. And so that's really partly what's happened to the party. And then, you know, look, it's... I think one of the great untold stories of this period of our history will be of the collaborators.
I'm truly fascinated by people's paths. And you know what? This is going to happen to you, Conrad. 25 years from now, you're going to look back and you're going to go, wow, I was like a producer on this nighttime radio show with this goofball. And you're going to go, and now I'm here. And I don't know where that's going to be, but you're going to look back and have moments. You're going to go, I can't believe that happened or that happened. And it got me here and it's going to be cool.
You know where I'm going to be? A Speedo model.
Oh, listen, it's not too late.
It's never too late.
Don't put them on backwards like I did once. That would be... So we have to start talking about that because next Friday, let's talk about that. We have to figure out how to present that. But yeah. Conrad and I will be wearing Speedos next Friday night. We will find a reason. That is something to look forward to or be horrified by, whatever. We'll talk more as it gets closer. But anyway, I think that's really cool. And I think, you know, I like talking to people who've had different, kind of ended up where they weren't sure they were going to. And that's been the case with me. I never thought I would move back to the Midwest. We just got kind of a weird thing. Hey, let's do this. Our parents are there. Our kids are getting older. We want them to know their grandparents a little better. And where we live in Marinette is kind of a little Mayberry type area. We thought we'd try it. And look, it's been great. And we have fun. We got a great house. And we're very fortunate to live by family. But I never thought I'd live there. And it's surprising where you go, yeah, okay, I'm going to change it up. And I would have been happy if I stayed in L.A., but I mean, I've pretty much been happy everywhere. You just got to keep yourself amused. That's the key. That's what we've learned tonight, Conrad. You have to keep yourself amused.
I would say so.
you're like texting Todd, hey man, Schwaba's losing it. He's having some kind of. So tomorrow night on the show, folks, it is a bar band Friday night. Terry Barr will be here as she always is at 7:35 to bring us new music and sparkling conversation. We always love talking to Terry. She's introduced us to such bands as Cat and the Hurricane and Marta Hansen and Katie Scullin. She's just great. And she'll be here tomorrow night. Jimmy Cusco will be here tomorrow night at 6:35 early. Jimmy's going to be coaching football tomorrow. Wait, coaching or announcing?
Coaching.
He's done both, but he's coaching now. Okay.
I believe, yeah, he's a coach.
I think you're right.
Yeah.
He's literally going to step out of the huddle. The coaches aren't in the huddle.
How great would that be?
He's going to get on the phone with us and go, all right, on two. Oh, wait, sorry, Pete. Different conversation. But Jimmy will be here at 6:35, and then we might play a little best of that I think a lot of people didn't get to hear earlier in the week because of the debate with one of our favorite guests. So that'll be sort of a surprise tomorrow night at 7:05. But a good show tomorrow night, and yeah, lots more fun. But it's been fun. This has been a good night, good show. I love when you have different guests, too. Like, Al was great, you know, and then... who did we?
Jenna.
We had popcorn pick of the week. Oh, that's what I couldn't think of. I was like thinking, all I have is Todd's voice in my head. Benchmark. And I'm totally.
Pick of the week.
We had Benchmark at 6:35. No, we had our popcorn pick of the week. Check out Sandy's Poppers in Kenosha. And then, Jenna was fun to talk to. I am truly fascinated by cybersecurity. I think that just seems like a cool job. And like they're really making a difference, you know, because that is an issue. Have you ever been hacked?
You know, on Safari, it'll let you know sometimes. Or no, really? Sorry, Firefox.
Oh, really?
Yeah, it'll say your information has been leaked or something on top when you open the first browser. I'm like, well, how did that happen?
Really?
Yeah. But I can't say I've actually been like really hacked, like scared about it.
I will say identity theft scares the living daylights out of me because I've heard horror stories. And just what Jenna was talking about the other day about getting her money back from her bank account, you know. So anyway, thank you to Tom at Sandy's Poppers and Jenna Watkins and Al Pitrelli. And thank you for all your texts as well. Thank you to Dave Grohl for giving us something to talk about tonight and the people who designed Coke-flavored Oreos. That I broke a fast with pizzazz tonight. You know, one of these days, have we done a question, Conrad, where we talk about our least favorite actors? I feel like we probably have.
I don't think we've done least favorite movies, I think. I can't remember if we've done. Yeah.
I know we should do that because it was Ryan Felipe's birthday this week. He might be a really nice guy. I find him so dull to watch. He's like this really handsome guy. He usually plays like a action guy or early in his career, he was like the cool guy in high school. Now he's older. And he did the spinoff of the movie Shooter with Mark Wahlberg, which was not a great movie to begin with, but they turned it into a series. And Ryan Felipe plays a Marine where somehow the Taliban has come to America and they're targeting Marines that stole their money. The whole premise is just not very believable to begin with, but his name is Bob Lee Swagger.
Oh, that's like, a cool name.
Yeah. That's what they want you to think. You're playing right into their, but Bob Lee Swagger, Robert Lee, Confederate general, I get it. And then Swagger, Bob Lee Swagger. And they always call him by like his last name, like curse you Swagger. But I don't know.
You know who's my least favorite actor?
Not Adam Sandler.
Well, he's sitting across the glass over there.
I'm your least favorite actor? Oh, man. You know what?
The national news cycle never stops, but it can be hard to find news about your local community. Civic Media is dedicated to providing quality local and state news coverage across Wisconsin. With the Civic Media app, you can get notifications about local stories that matter to you and your community. Find the free Civic Media app in your phone's app store and choose notifications from the menu to tell us what kind of news you want to hear about.